So it appears from the subject as if this is a confrontation between the mother tongue and other tongue means English. And mother tongue in this case is a host of Indian languages, not one language, so many languages. But to my mind, English today is no longer the other or the binary other to the Bhasha languages. In Raja Rao, it is said that Raja Rao, when he wrote his introduction to Kanthapura, he put the Brahmanical thread, Brahmanical sacred thread on English, thereby initiating it into the India's linguistic family. So you can treat it in English as a part of the Indian linguistic family. Though not in the 8th schedule of the constitution, English is one of the languages in which the Sahitya Academy has been giving awards since 1960. English is also the official language of 3 of our Indian states. English has survived the attack of nationalists and politicians, Hindi enthusiasts, the Indian constitution, which had sought to set a time limit on its use for official purposes. Some of the states which had removed English teaching from schools have brought it back. So we cannot therefore call English the other tongue, and a more appropriate use would be perhaps anti-tongue that Mr. Trivedi has already mentioned. So talking about anti-tongue, I think if I take an Indian political analogy, so English is not to be taken as the imported European madam. It is the Indian auntie who stands on level with Behenji, Amma, and Didi. Then I come to the term Indian languages. When you say Indian languages, obviously you are referring to non-English languages. The description has kept on changing, like that of the terminology Negro in the USA, who have been successively called blacks, darky, colored, Negro, and now African American. Our own untouchables were at one time being called depressed class, then called scheduled caste, Harijan. Now, Harijan is a bad word. I think it is a penal offense to call somebody a Harijan. Now, of course, the preferred term is Dalit. Similarly, for our languages, they were once called vernacular. Then it was objected to, as the word came from Varna, which meant it was a language of home-born slaves. Then it was called regional language and Indian language, but the present preference seems to be Bhasha. And perhaps sometimes Bhasha will be treated as a bad word, and we'll have to find out some other new word. And about this confrontation between Bhasha and English, this is nothing new. I mean, it has been regenerated in the recent past, but this has always been so, because English was the language of our colonial masters. I don't think there was any such resistance to Sanskrit or Persian, which were also the language of the ruling masters and the elite, but English has been facing this from the earliest times. I'll give a history of the people, great men who have objected to use of English. It starts with Chiplunkar, the Marathi writer who was an inspiration to Tilak. He writes in 1881, "Crushed by English poetry, our freedom has been destroyed." Gandhi wrote in Hind Swaraj, that was in 1909, "To give millions a knowledge of English is to enslave them. Indian parents who train their children to think and talk in English from their infancy betray their children and their country." A little later, Premchand said, "Hamari paradhinta ka sabse apmanjanak, sabse vyapak, sabse kathor angrezi bhasha ka prabhutva hai." So, which means the dominance of English language is the most demeaning, the most extensive and the harshest aspect of our subjugation. Our own Fakir Mohan Senapati wrote in one of his short stories, Dakamun Sigopare Likchanti, "Se Pionta Murkha Ingraji Padhi Nahi Tara Gotae Desi Hrudaya Achi," which translates, the peon is illiterate, he has not learnt English, so he has a native heart. I think in this visual which was presented before the show, about languages, I think Hart was very much mentioned. So English literature was taken as a shorthand for English language and culture, and was taken to task by all these masters. This has been very graphically illustrated in a scene in J.G. Farrell's novel of the Sipai Mutiny, The Siege of Krishnapur. The embattled British are holed up in their own place. They're running short of cannonballs to fire at the sepoys marching towards them. You, of course, you know about it. So they run short of cannonballs. So they start using household items like pots and pans and somebody's denture. But the most effective of all the commodities fired at the sepoys is a head of Shakespeare taken from Collector Hopkins' collection of electrometal figures of great men of British cultural history. This particular head of Shakespeare seethed its way through a whole astonished platoon of sepoys advancing in single file. So the effectiveness of Shakespeare suggests allegorically the complicity between Indian English culture and British military power in colonial subjugation of India. Despite such antagonism to English, India did accept English language wholeheartedly, and Macaulay's dream had come true. As early as in 1866, Dinabandhu Mitra's play, Shodhobar Ekadashi, in that play, the English educated character Babu Nimchand Datta says, "I read English, write English, speechify in English, dream in English." And more than 100 years later, Amitabh Bachchan was to repeat a similar sentiment in the film Namak Halal, 1982. His character Arjun Singh is appearing before an interview board for a hotel job. He says, "I know such English that I can leave Angrez behind. You see, sir, I can talk English, I can walk English, I can laugh English." But he very cunningly adds, "because English is a funny language." Knowing English was always an advantage during British rule, and as it was an advantage to know Persian during Mughals. In the same story that I mentioned, Dhaka Munsi, Fakirmohan writes, "Tikiye Ingraji na janile ke tete bado chakiri ta meliba mushkil." It's difficult to get a big job without some knowledge of English. It still holds true, especially after globalization, and I think we have accepted the fact that English has to be learned by Indians. Then I come to the fact that how is that some writers choose to write in English rather than mother tongues. For some of them, like Harish has already mentioned, perhaps English is their mother tongue. Some perhaps feel that they can express themselves better in English, or that writing in English will give them a wider readership and other benefits. Many writers writing a language not their own have been great writers, and examples of Conrad and Beckett and Nabokov will come to one's mind. There are many writers who write in their mother tongue as also in English, equally well in both languages. I think I must come to the point now that in this seminar here this time, you will find there is a whole host of English teachers. I think 90% of the speakers, the facilitators, they're English. Starting from Mr. Chandrasekhar Rath, Manoj Babu sitting there, then Dipti Ranjan and Jatin Nayak. So they're all English teachers who have, but they're also English teachers who have written in their own languages, and they're better known as Oriya writers. And then Harish has done tremendous, immense work on Hindi literature. So it's not that somebody has to choose between English or his language. It could be handling both the languages equally well, which all these people have done. And some have chosen to write poetry in one language, prose in another, or vice versa. Jayanta Mahapatra, after decades of writing in English, switched over to Oriya and said, "It took me 30 years to realize that poetry cannot be written the same way as it can be written in one's mother tongue." I don't agree, because I think, friends, I'm sorry about the clapping, but I said I don't agree in the sense that I don't think his Jayanta's poems in English is any worse than his poems in Oriya. So I think the confrontation between English and the Indian languages was revived with Salman Rushdie's New Yorker article. So I think the stage has come. I think nobody seriously takes note of that. We don't care about what he said. And it has been pointed out that though he said that in 1997, that all the good work was being done by Indo-Anglian literature, in a 1983 essay, I think they're all commonplace things for people, but I'll say that. In 1983, the same Rushdie had said, Commonwealth literature does not exist. That was the title of his article. He had said, it is also worth saying that major work is being done in India in many languages other than English. Yet outside India, there is just about no interest in any of this work. The Indo-Anglians seize all the limelight. I think that contradicts himself, and then that's the end of the matter. Then the other point I will make is, what are the concern of the Bhasha writer and the English writer? It's not the same really. So that is where the problem perhaps takes place. Meenakshi Mukherjee, who did a study of the 19th century novelists, has made this distinction between Indian writers, Bhasha writers, and Indian writers write in English on the same subjects. She writes, though the early novelists in Indian languages and in Indian English belong to the same social segment, the upper caste Hindu male, the Indian English novelist did not antagonize the British in India, while the Bhasha novels had become a major vehicle of political dissent. I think that is where the distinction can be made between the Bhasha writers and the Indo-English writers. The fact is that Bhasha writers and Indo-English writers have been articulating different concerns in their writings. Despite differences in Bhasha literatures between Oriya and Bengali and Assamese and Hindi and all that, the differences due to difference in regional concerns, varying places of phases of development of the languages, differing responses to outside influences and interventions, there are many common elements. There is a commonality of cultural ethos, value systems, and consciousness of the Bhasha writers because of India's philosophical traditions, mythologies and rituals, shared oral and folk tradition, and similar levels of urbanization and modernization. Unfortunately, the writers who write in English, they are not concerned with many of these issues. And it is said that for the Indian English writers, in contrast, their preoccupation, especially in the post-independence diasporic writing, is exotica, history, fantasy, collision, and the use of third space. I think that sets apart the Indian writers writing in Indian languages and the writers who write original in English. So I'll now come to some myths about the writers who write in English as contrasted to writers who write in Bhasha languages. One myth is that in the public imagination, the Indo-English writers get million-dollar advances, go around the world on book promotion tours, get translated into 100 languages, sign fat contract for film rights, and are honored with international prizes. To put the matter straight, this is about fiction writing only, and about a few writers, couple maybe, like Rushdie, Vikram Seth, Amitav Ghosh, and it certainly does not apply to hundreds or thousands of other writers. To my mind, some sort of a rigid caste system operates in this society of authors, and the authors I named belong to the Brahmanical order. Then the others who belong to the lower orders, some make good money and appear on page three, but are ignored by critics and literary establishment. A still lower order is that of authors published by Indian publishing houses. Their books are never reviewed anywhere. They sell a few hundred copies and are soon pulped and forgotten. And I'm not talking about the innocent hopefuls from the rural India who publish in vanity press in small towns. They're not even considered as authors in any language. And then the other question about the circulation of the books by Bhasha writers as compared to English writers. I think you can take it as a fact that not many English books get into as many editions as Bhasha books do. I think this is only a speculation that I'm making, but I think that is the true position. This is certainly true of poetry, where the print run of an English book of poems is no higher than its Bhasha counterpart. I think if we Oriya poetry books are printed in 300 copies, so are English collections of poetry books. And I am sure no Indo-English book of poetry in recent years has reached the circulation of Ramakant Rath's Sri Radha. Let that fact be challenged by anybody. And the other thing is about wide recognition by writers who write in English. Of course, these writers have the advantage of an all-India market because they're not geographically limited. But what gave them wide circulation is their inclusion in university textbooks. I think Ezekiel was known not by his other great writings, but because of Night of the Scorpion. Because that poem was included in every textbook, so he got to be known. Fortunately, things are changing. English textbooks are now including selections from Bhasha literature in translation. Translation from Bhasha are being published not only by Sahitya Academy and NBT, but also by reputed publishing houses. Bhasha writers are thus no longer confined to their geographical boundaries and have gained all India recognition and reputation. That is how Anantamurthy is better than many Indo-English writers, and certainly, say, Sachidanandan or Sitakant Mahapatra are no lesser known than Keki Daruwala or Arvind Krishna Mehrotra. Thank you.
Thank you.